What's up, everybody? It's Lexi D here. In this video, I'm going to be walking you all through age 30 for me. I turned 31 on December 15th of this year, and I wanted to share with you all the highs, the lows, and everything that happened in between. So if you want to hear more, then keep watching, and let's get started. So age 30 started off pretty great for me, actually. I was in Belize, and this was December of 2019, and had such a great time there with my friends and everything. And then boom, here came, you know, February, and early February, I was actually fired from my job. I have a video discussing that further, so I'll have that linked below. But that experience for me was traumatic. Like, if there's one word I could use to describe it, was traumatic. That was supposed to be my dream job. I saw myself there for some time. And to have been there for a year and a half and everything that transpired leading up to that point, it was a really rough thing for me to reconcile in my mind what my identity was outside of my job, what it meant to have a supportive job, to reframe what I actually needed in a job. Because like I said, this was my dream job, right? This was the job that I wrote down everything that I wanted, and this job pretty much had all of it, and I wasn't happy. I was actually more stressed out in that job than I was my former job that I had been trying to leave, right? So that experience taught me a lot. It's still teaching me a lot. I am fortunate enough that when I was fired, I was given another job opportunity, not even a week later. So from that standpoint of things, I mean, that is a whole story in itself of God's grace and just relying on God and really being faithful, because I can't even reconcile that in my mind of having been fired at 12 noon and having a job interview at 3 p.m. going in there, I'm shaking. I had just, you know, had a meltdown and killing it and getting a job offer the following week, right? So that whole experience could have been it for me this year, and I would have been cool. There's still so much that I can learn from that situation. And so being in the position that I'm at now in terms of like my career and where I see myself this year, I really got a better idea of what it is that I see for myself in the next few years. And that's that I want to work for myself. I want to work for myself and work with other project managers, do coaching, mentoring, all of that kind of stuff. I love project management as a profession. At the same time, I've been doing it for 8 years now. It doesn't mean that there's nothing else that I can learn or that there's not anything else I can grow in terms of corporate. But in terms of what I want to do, and more importantly, the life I want to lead and the impression that I want to leave on folks and how I want to help folks, this is the direction that I want to go into of coaching PMs, right? No matter how that looks. And so I'll definitely have to see how that's going to unfold, but I'm excited. I'm excited to continue on my current job and also build my business off to the side. It's definitely scary and a little bit intimidating, but I know it's possible, and I'm excited to see what's going to come of it. I prioritized my mental health this year, y'all. I went to therapy. I made it a point to go to therapy once a week, get my butt in that chair, sit there in my feelings, drain myself of everything, and leave that office and go home and practice self-care. That was my priority this year. I made sure to go to therapy. I had two things in mind that I wanted to work on. That was around managing stress from work, as well as managing the romantic relationships in my life. I have another video dedicated to sharing with y'all my therapy story. I'll have that linked below as well. And in its essence, therapy for me was a very good tool to help me understand better about myself and to learn how to better better manage myself, my emotions, and to express myself. This was a year where I really tapped into vulnerability. I used to think of vulnerability as just being blunt, like, oh, I'm a blunt person. People may say I'm mean, but hey, at least I'm being honest. And maybe that's part of it, but not really. Like, I've learned that vulnerability is more so being able to speak from a place of honesty, yes, but also you put yourself out there a little bit, right? Like, you put yourself in a position where you may be rejected, where someone may judge you. And at the same time, it's so beneficial because there's so many good things. As scary as vulnerability can be, it's absolutely required if you're going to live out your truest self, right? If you're going to be your truest self, if you are going to take care of your needs, you have to be vulnerable. And it is intense and it is scary, but it is something that is also so beautiful once it's done. And so you know, going through that experience of therapy and finishing therapy and finally coming to, and finally coming to the revelation that I needed to be the person to take care of my needs. I needed to be the person to advocate for myself. It's a scary thing, but it's also empowering. It's the thing that finally made me cut off this guy in my life who, we had a very toxic relationship and it wasn't serving me. I'm sure it wasn't serving him. And it just, it was a mess. It was a mess. It was very stressful and it was a lot. And once I made that commitment to myself that I was going to take care of my needs, it made it a lot easier for me to leave that relationship. There was a lot in my mind mentally around dealing with this one voice that was constantly on my back telling me you're making a big deal. You're constantly telling me you're making a big deal out of this. Just minimizing. It was a minimizing voice versus the other voice in my head that was like, no, you don't feel good in this situation. That's enough for you to walk away. You do not need a laundry list. You don't need to do an analysis. You don't want to do this. This doesn't feel good to you. Leave, you know? And so finally, giving into that voice and minimizing the minimizing voice, right? Or just, you know, completely ignoring that voice altogether. That's still something I deal with. But in this particular situation, I'm very proud of myself for making the decision that I made. Truthfully, I think I'd still be in the situation if I didn't make that decision. So definitely going to therapy, cutting out this toxic person out of my life or toxic relationship, because honestly, I was toxic in that relationship as well. So just ending that completely, it was such a huge accomplishment this year for me. This year, I really got into the idea of essentialism and minimalism. I read a book on essentialism and I've been watching a lot of videos on minimalism, and I watched a documentary on Netflix around minimalism. It's just super appealing to me. I think at one point I, like probably most Americans, have used buying things as a distraction from coping with other things that maybe we just didn't want to face, we didn't want to deal with. There's a lot in this world that you can use to easily distract yourself, whether it's watching TV, listening to a lot of music, eating, overeating, right? Just doing anything in excess. And so the idea of moving towards essentialism and minimalism is very appealing to me, because the way that I interpret it is spending your time on those things that you value, right? Whether that is, you know, a couple of things or people or moments with yourself. And so even just kind of on like a very micro level, I have found myself for weeks on end wearing the same clothes. And at one point I thought that I'd be depressed maybe wearing the same clothes, like I'd be uninspired or something. But I loved my blacks. Like if it's hot out, I'm wearing a tank top and shorts. If it's cold out, I'm wearing something like this in leggings or a longer sweater. You know, I live in LA, so what is really cold? But in any case, I've learned that it's something that actually reduces the amount of energy that I have to spend on what am I gonna wear? How does this fit? This is something I can wear. I know I'm gonna be comfortable. It works. I can go out of the house at any given moment and don't have to worry about putting something else on. And so even things like that on a very micro level, but even on a more granular level, spending time like playing the game we're not really strangers. I think that's the name of the game. I'm gonna have it linked below, but it's a card game that I started playing. I learned about during this whole period of quarantine and everything, and playing that game with family members, with friends, and learning things about my loved ones that I probably would have never learned. That's something else that happened for me during the age of 30, was just coming to these revelations around other people and really gaining insight about who people really are. And it's been such a beautiful thing. I don't know that I would officially call myself an essentialist or a minimalist, but it's very appealing for those reasons that I've illustrated, of just being able to really spend my time and energy on the things that I value the most. Now, age 30 is an age where there's expectations through the roof about having kids, about being married, about owning a home. Yes, I own my own condo. I'm super happy about that. But in terms of having kids and getting married, I don't know when that's going to happen or if that's going to happen, y'all. And that's something that I'm still exploring within myself, of if I have a true desire to have those two things, or if there is if there is a part of me that is doubting that so much that I'm like, I don't even know if I can have the desire. So that's something that I'm working through. But in all honesty, I've never had an urge to have children, number one. And then when it comes to being married, I can't recall a time that I ever planned out my wedding or thought about what married life would be like. Like, maybe I thought, oh, it would be nice to have a partner to go grocery shopping with. But getting to the next point that I was going to make with y'all, I went on an international solo trip by myself. And that was like the icing on the cake in terms of being able to do things by myself. Whenever I envision myself in a partnership, you know, in a relationship, I think of that person doing things with me, especially like traveling, trying out new restaurants, going to concerts. Now, concerts, I don't know when that's going to happen again. But even still, this year before things shut down, I went to concerts by myself and I had so much fun because I didn't have to worry about someone else and if they were really into it and if they wanted to leave. I could just be solely focused on what I wanted to be focused on. Same thing when I was on my trip. So I went on, we're gonna take a little detour and then we'll come back. I went on my first ever solo international trip to the Dominican Republic this year. It was my first time going to the Dominican Republic, but I love going to the Caribbean, so I knew I was going to at least have a great time from that perspective. It was definitely nerve-wracking. I didn't know if I was going to have as much fun, at least by myself, but I did. And I bring this up because that is a feat in itself, and it's definitely inspired me to take more international or just solo trips, period, right? But also because if I don't need a partner to travel internationally, to go to concerts, to try new foods, what do I actually need one for? I like to be kind of pragmatic about this because I don't want to have a relationship, have kids, just because it feels like it's something that I'm supposed to do, right? That is not in my nature to make those kinds of big decisions, right, based on what society says. And so it's something I'm still thinking about, you know? I'm not worried about the whole age of, oh, well, you know, you gotta have kids before 35 because if you don't have them before 35, it's high risk. And that's real, right? That's a real thing. That's medicine, science, all of that is real. But for me, I think it's more important than running on this sense of urgency because of science, trusting God, that God is going to lay out a plan, a situation, a man, whatever for me that's going to be best fit for me and custom tailor-made for me, right? So until then, I'm just going to keep enjoying life. We'll see what happens over the next year, over the next few years. But listen, on an individual level, y'all, this year of being 30 years old, overall, it was great. There were things that happened that I shared with y'all, but it was great. I had a lot of fun this year. I learned a lot about myself. I made food. So for Thanksgiving, I made mac and cheese and I made sweet potatoes. Like, what is it? Not flavored sweet potatoes, yams. What is it called? Whatever. I made mac and cheese and I baked some sweet potatoes, mashed sweet potatoes, put some sugar, all that kind of stuff in it. And that was something that I never would have thought I could do. I don't know why. I just had it in my mind. I'm like, I'm not a cook. Same thing with being able to do my own sugar wax. I did my own Brazilian sugar wax, y'all. Like, this, so many things that I did for myself this year that part of it was the pandemic forcing me. And at the same time, it also helped to infuse some more confidence in me. So yeah, ultimately 30 was a great year for me. I'm looking forward to 31. It is a little bit of an awkward year because it's like, what's 31? It's like being 18 and then turning 19. You're like, what is this year? I don't really know, but hey, it's another year that I'm here, so I'm feeling blessed. And in any case, I want to thank y'all for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, make sure to give it a thumbs up, and I will catch y'all in my next one. Deuces.